Hey everybody, welcome back to our channel. My name is Brittany Simon. For those of you who don't know, my life has been a hot mess. My 20s were a mess.
People, no matter who they are, remind me that love, real love, is the most important thing.
That's just deep, bro. That's deep.
My 30s have been much better. I think, because I have radical acceptance. I went through a journey, a life, and much similar to yours, I had ups and downs.
Like, in reality, I'm perfectly healthy. I'm totally fine. But inside of my brain, I am a complete worthless person. This is temporary. This is not real. This is my brain not being able to process negative emotion because of past trauma. This is the BPD flaring up, and this is my chance to utilize tools to make myself feel better.
And much similar to many people's, I wondered if I was going to survive it. I thought about dying. I definitely tried to commit suicide. I've definitely had a long few decades of struggle, but the last 2 years have been a change in my life.
Don't do it, Brittany.
As many of you guys know, in the last 2 years, I became a 5. So 2 years ago this month, hence the reason we're making this video, I experienced what I believe is like radical acceptance, enlightenment, awakening, the idea of knowing your place in the universe, whatever words you want to use, whatever language we're sharing with one another. I believe that I live in the most real understanding of existence, which is to radically accept that I know little to nothing and that I believe many things, but most of my life has been an understanding through belief instead of an understanding through knowing.
We've got a lot to report about, so let's get right to some of the information.
As for the fraud allegation, the cars and disguises and so on, I am told that we may have some video of that. All right, obviously that is from the Ringling Brothers in Barnum Bailey Circus. Maybe that is where Mr. Trump got the idea of people going into their cars and changing disguises.
Americans held hostage, abandoned behind enemy lines. Day 68.
And welcome to Hannity. Yep, 68 long days. Our Americans, fellow Americans, their families, our allies, thousands of green card holders, all trapped behind the enemy lines of the Taliban, abandoned by your president, Joe Biden. Of course, Biden has simply moved on, or in his words, he's turned the page. After all, he has more important things to worry about. But that never stops Joe Biden from repeating one lie after another, in this case, on 5 separate occasions.
And all the while, the president continues to try to blame somebody else, anybody else, for what has gone wrong here.
So I am trying now to live an existence that is more about knowing while balancing what I believe.
What is truth?
I saw the truth that lies within it.
So the conclusion I'm coming to is a little bit different from your conclusion. It's not the one that I want to come to, and I would like to resist it. But the conclusion I'm coming to is quite simply, we're fucked.
Yes, but that's always been true, right? The apocalypse is always, that's why the apocalypse is eternal, because the world's always coming to an end. And it's actually true in small ways and in great ways. With regards to your ideas about truth, I would say that, like language, truth is more like a process. And I would say it's a process that you actually embody rather than conceptualize abstractly.
As many of you guys know, I do believe life is tiny contradictions, right? We talk about that a lot on this channel. We want to be open, but have boundaries. We want to accept that humans are going to human. All of these things, I think, are needed. They're stepping stones. They're foundational pieces we need to understand the self and the why. So the why is key to everything I understand about humanity and my own existence. So I believe I exist. There's my existing. And then I believe existence surrounds me. You are existence. This interaction is existence. There's like a lot of contradictions that happen throughout life, but yet we maintain and move forward. And still, even with all the statistical probabilities of harm, when we socialize with one another, human beings, for some reason, not only have continued to socialize, but we're doing pretty good. Now, I didn't always believe that humanity was doing good. At one point in my life when I was a two is a person like most people born into bubbles, lives in bubbles, believes the bubbles are correct and objective.
And I look at the world around us, I think of all the ways we could avoid hurt and pain and violence. It's interesting to me when I see people bringing babies into an environment that is unhealthy, and we wonder why these kids grow up and then take guns and shoot up schools. Well, maybe it was because they grew up in an unstable environment, and maybe it's our job as a society to maybe sit back and say, maybe we shouldn't be procreating like it's no big deal.
When I was a two, whether I was on the right or the left, as long as I was a two, I really believed that this was the objective truth. That humans were bad, that humans were cynical, that humans were liars and hypocrites and cheaters. Holy crap, this last week on TikTok, it really puts you into a mode of fearing other human beings. I saw one with an interview of a therapist, and he asked her, what's something your job has taught you about humanity that surprised you? And she said, a lot more people are cheating than we think. And that's hard for me as somebody who's been cheated on and as somebody whose honor system, whose value system has a no cheating policy. That's really difficult. But I also radically accept that cheaters exist, that some people who cheat are good people and some people who cheat are bad people. And I have a lot of bias that holds in my body when I hear the word cheating, but a lot of nuance in my mind, my intelligence allows me to understand that, of course, statistically, there has to be somebody out there who's a cheater and yet a good person. And so I have to live with the contradictions of my existence by radically accepting them. So my body and my mind, my intelligence and my emotions have a harmonious relationship. It's not always balanced because I'm not a god. It's not always perfect because nobody is perfect. So when reaching 5, I came to the conclusion through a curiosity of why.
Why?
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 I couldn't have continued existing without finding out the why because my brain works the way it does for me. So many of you guys saw me over the last decade being suicidal and crazy and needy and borderline and depressed and anxious. In the last 2 years, I have not been anxious, depressed, in a medical way, in a bad way. You know, everyone experiences anxiety, but I mean real anxiety, depression, suicidal ideations, attempts, of course not. And then everything else that I did in the past, my borderline episodes, my triggers, all of them have subsided. I radically want to know myself. I want to know every part of this body. I want to be able to communicate everything that I am to the person that I'm interacting with when it's appropriate in and with boundaries, which I could not do as a 2. I didn't understand boundaries very well. I thought I did, but I really didn't until recently. So of course, one of the questions I get asked a lot in conjunction with what I'm saying is, oh, does that mean enlightenment or awakening or whatever you want to call it, finding inner peace, does that mean that it cures mental illness? Not technically. So interestingly enough, obviously, I think environmental factors weigh in on us. And this, to me, is the most significant thing about being a 5. And again, you can be a joyful 2 and you can be a joyful 5. But I think those of you who have the why question burning at you, you will eventually get to 5. And then the people who don't, reality will be reflected in your actions and you'll probably just stay a 2, but at least you can be joyful, a whole human being, a 2 or a 5. So obviously, we know there's like a medical side to us and a spiritual side. Okay. And we know those mental sides can impact our physical and physical can impact our mental. We know that I, as an example, have borderline or PTSD as an example. You could take either. And both have been in remission for the last 2 years, ever since I reached this radical acceptance. So I haven't had any issues, but my body still holds a lot of that trauma. So what I notice is that I'll be having a perfectly normal conversation with a human, but after so much of that particular energy, sometimes I can get so exhausted emotionally and like my spoons are gone, I'm an introvert, all these things, that I can feel myself, my body being hit first. And when my body is weak, my mind is weak. So for me personally, I always need to keep a balance. As long as I'm drinking my water, eating my food and sleeping properly, meditating, processing and making sure to live within my spoon, like how much energy I actually have instead of going beyond that, I don't face my triggers. So this could be a connection to the fact that I'm physically taking care of my body better than I ever did before, because before I was sleeping 4 hours a week, working 100 hours a week, whatever it was crazy, going out every night, socializing, having tons of sex, doing drugs, drinking, just abusing my body. And I was getting triggered all the time, suicidal, borderline, depressed, all these things. And I was still asking myself the why. I was still reading thousands of books. I was still watching documentaries. I was still interacting. I was still trying to live my life. So it's not like the problem solving went away. So you could hear my story and say, oh, well, obviously it was age that made her stable. No, she went to therapy and she got diagnosed as borderline and that made her better. Oh, it was the fact that she read a lot. It's all of it. All of it is the reason I'm the person I am. I have to have the lived experiences to, you know, compare it next to the notes I've taken. You know, you can read about life in a book all you want, but until you put it into action, you don't understand how much of it impacts you. My body holds so many memories. One of the tools that I do or use through meditation is closure. I meditate for closure. I tell my body, it's time we let go of this memory and you really need to let it go. You need to move on from this memory. You can't keep holding it inside of your body. So one of the things that I still struggle with personally is when I am faced in a situation, let's say with my mother, who I love. You guys know I love my mom. If you come at my mom, I will come at you. You know what I'm saying? I will come at you. So my mom is chill, but after 3 or 4 days, we really got on each other's nerves. And a big part of it is that my mom is a very strong and proud woman. I mean, she did not immigrate here just to back down. You know what I'm saying? So my mom is beholden, believes with every fiber of her body that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, that he is the objective creationist, that we are his creations, and that Catholicism, Roman Catholicism, is the only answer. And I am here to support her in that endeavor and that belief. But when it comes to my own existence, obviously I don't live in that bubble. I don't believe she has the objective answer. I believe there is much more that we do not know about the creation or reasoning for the human existence. A lot of people settle for, we've come from nothing, we are nothing. I personally don't believe that. I think we are something, obviously, and we're going to go back to something. I actually take a more positive spin, which can correlate to my mental health getting better, meaning the way I saw the world became more optimistic. So again, in order for me to even process the why, I had to get rid of all the bias that I hold in my body. But the thing I still struggle with is that borderline energy, that PTSD energy, that flight or fight, fight, flight or freeze energy that I have to deal with when I'm with my mom, because I trust my mother. And as a child, when I would ask my mom questions about creationists or life or Christianity or being Iraqi or whatever we were, she always gave me an answer through the lens of Christ. And because of that, couldn't give me objective answers to things I later learned through science or education or my lived life that she didn't have the objective answer to, and lived a life in which her brain said it was objective, but I knew it wasn't because I could literally go over here and test it out. Whoops. Gosh, I really hope this is making sense. I feel a little bit like I'm all over the place, but I want to explain it because this is how my brain works. I feel like my brain is just a bunch of scattered like cobwebs or like lines of knowledge, and every line has a point, and I just like shuffle through all my memories to the right point. And so right now I'm trying to remember that all these layers were happening in conjunction. You know, I was a person who, in order to be a whole human being, knowing who you are in the anime, your trope, you know, knowing how you are doing physically, emotionally, spiritually, and fiscally, you know, getting those things under control, that was the path into enlightenment. That was the path. Because whether you're a 2 or a 5, a person who decides to ask why and seek it out, or a person who asks why and stops, you still have to be a whole human being. You're just experiencing life differently. There were so many people, like Chelsea Handler did ayahuasca and felt like her whole life changed, and she felt like she knew so much about herself.
When you've done a lot of damage to your brain, is it reversible? I'm just asking for a friend.
Oh, for sure.
I want to be the best version of myself that I can be.
I'm going to Peru to do ayahuasca. It's supposed to be one of those transformative experiences. People say that it changes their life.
Oh my God.
Anything that's not your regular state of being is mind expanding, I think.
And then she remained a 2, going around saying very 2 things, still very undereducated, but trying, very lack of introspection, but trying.
You drank ayahuasca tea that's used in spiritual awakenings among the indigenous peoples of Peru.
Yes.
How did that work out?
You hallucinate. Well, the first time it didn't hit me, I have a very high tolerance. You purge, they call it purging, and you purge, and then you have all these hallucinations about your childhood. It's very, very vivid, like vivid imagery.
And is that good? I mean, like, did you get something from it?
Yeah, I mean, I had forgotten that I loved my sister.
All right.
So I told her right away. I was like, hey, girl, love you again.
And in her world of the 2s, she did something magnificent. She moved through her own levels of introspection within the 2 bubble, and that's really good for her.
You also do one on racism.
Yes.
And you actually talk to some people from my home state of South Carolina who say that, well, slavery wasn't that bad. Did you freak out on them when they said that? Like, what was your reaction? How did you control yourself?
I didn't, because these documentaries were an exercise in restraint. I wanted to do something that I knew nothing about because I just wanted to be out of my comfort zone.
And you know nothing about racism? Where
I knew
did you
nothing
grow up?
About documentaries. I met a lot of people that were intellectuals that were racists, that, you know, had a college education, that, I mean,
some
were
of them
very
are running
spoken.
For president.
Yeah.
But if you took Chelsea and put her into a different bubble, she would radically understand very quickly how non-objective her life is, as many of us would. Humility brought me to a place where I could accept that my brain was broken. I had borderline stemming from a childhood in which subjective truth was fed into me. And when I literally questioned it, found out the real objective answer, I was traumatized. I was traumatized. From my queerness to the belief in God, to the idea of magic, to the idea of humans, like, what are we all doing here? Traumatized. And then I healed from that trauma. But still, when I visit my mother, sometimes it can come up again, and my body remembers those memories of feeling trapped in a conservative home as a queer kid who thought she was going to hell, or as a person in general who really questioned why she was here. And I felt like there was a deeper answer. But the deeper answer doesn't necessarily mean objectively better. I think the issue with twos and talking to twos and talking to most of you in my audience, because most of you are twos, right? You would naturally be, is that there's a comparison that happens in our brain naturally, a desire to go from A to Z, a desire to say, I want the thing that's bigger, better, the thing to say, I want to evolve to more. So when I say you don't have to get to a five, you can stay a two, you still hear a numerical system, you hear linear, you see a path, and you see me and probably think, I want a Brittany's joy, or I want the thing that she has, or that the energy I see in her that's different from her past Brittany till now. I want whatever that is, but I'm telling you, you can get it. Joy, whether you're a two or a five, the difference is, do you know what it's like to be a human in relation to all of existence, all of the bubbles? And are you willing to have that conversation with yourself about how to navigate that world with people that don't see the universe the same way as you? I see so many people on the internet that I think to myself, oh, I really like their brain. I really like a lot of people's brains, okay? And when I like someone's brain, I want to interact with them because it stimulates me. I personally have a purpose that is about my family. But outside of my purpose, my reason for not killing myself, you know what I mean? My family, my joy, is my work and the work that I do getting to know human beings. I genuinely, through this journey, have come to so many moments where I've gotten the chance to really let go of a lot of the pain and the suffering that I was holding on to. And instead of turning it into a total Voldemort or a Trisha Paytas or a Gabby Hanna or anyone else who's obviously still struggling in the same age group that I'm in, minus Voldemort, you know, because we could all go down these paths. I took a completely different direction because honestly, I need to know why. And I hold no more. Okay, this used to happen, but I no longer hold any desire for a specific answer out of the universe. I don't hold any beliefs that I'm a slave to, meaning I believe all humans are good. Maybe because my mental health is good and now I'm seeing the world through this very positive lens, hence this journey. You know, before it was all negative, the world sucks because I sucked, and now I'm better and I'm like, oh, the world's kind of cool. And I think that's because I'm better. And I'm able to see that, yeah, the world sucks in a lot of ways, but it's also really good. And it's both those things all the time. All the time. Always has been for all of our ancestors. We are not special. If we really believe that we deserve a great life because we exist, then you're discounting every other person who had to exist in the same bullshit we do. And we continue the cycle because you continue that belief that you're better than other people and you deserve to have better lives than them. But the truth is, I think people should have the lives that best serve them, and that's not going to look the same objectively. So again, maybe I'm only seeing the world positively because I've gotten more positive, but I would say all of these things connect. And they connect so specifically. So it looks simple, and it is, but it's also very complicated and there's a lot of layers. When you and I are having conversations, I have to have them in specific ways because I know specific people will hear them. I'll give you an example. I haven't gotten the vaccine yet, as many of you know, and a lot of people were really shocked, you know, when they find out, oh my gosh, like, I can't believe you haven't gotten the vax. And I was like, yeah, I haven't gotten it. And they're like, wow. And then some of my friends had these moments where they're like, I don't know what this means. You know, I don't know what this is telling me about our friendship, right? And we've all maintained our friendships. Everything's been great. It's been fine. I have really good friends. But it's one of those things where I knew they felt hurt. They actually felt, you know, they asked me, can I please ask you why you're not getting it and have a conversation with you about it? Recently, because I want to travel and I'm not going to die on the hill of vaccines, though I think it's unethical for people to make them mandatory. I also respect other countries for doing that. And I would like to travel in 2022. And if it means some of those countries won't let me in unless I'm vaxxed, I'm happy to get vaxxed. And that hurts my right side of the family. Like, my mom's a little worried. I reached out to some people. I have a couple people who had bad reactions to the vaccine. I heard from some nurses, doctors that they're having some issues with women and getting pregnant and things like that. And personally, I want to have children. So there's a lot of like anxiety that goes into taking something that I'm going to tell you right now. I don't understand what's in it. I don't know what's in it. I believe it's fine, but I don't know that. And so I wouldn't be so arrogant as to be like, it's fine. Get it. I don't know that. I could never feel good about myself if I told someone to take something that I didn't know was okay. Even drugs, and I love drugs. When people say, Brittany, should I smoke weed? I go, well, maybe not. Let's talk about your mental health. Let's talk about where you're at. Maybe this thing that I love, that I smoke every day, that I most certainly smoked before I made this video, maybe that thing that's great for me isn't going to be great for you. But most people, most twos don't think like that. They think if it's good for me, it's good for you. Because why would I take something that's not good for me? And that leads me into fiveness. When I think about my life and why I'm so content and happy and I feel like I found the answers to my universe, a big part of it is that I have hurt for this conclusion. I have suffered. I have put myself in masochistic situations. I've challenged everything I've believed about myself. I've said statements and then gone and challenged them and realized, oops, you girl, wrong. I have failed so much in my life. I've embarrassed myself so many times, and all of it because I wanted to know why. And fives have this luxury and existence of just existing, enough so they can really enjoy these trials and errors. Of course, I believe I'm a whole human being now. I've been working on that so long, and I believe I've completed it, right? I'm where I want to be financially. And I have, by the way, and as you guys should, I don't do ideal goals. I do basic ideal goals, reach those, and anything extra is extra. So financially, I'm where I want to be. I can pay all my bills. I know where my income is coming from. I have a savings account, and I can provide for my family. So I feel pretty good. Do I want to make more so I can have a retreat center? Yes. Is that necessary to fulfill my purpose as a human? Not at all. Because my purpose is my family. So as long as we're good and I can supply like a good foundation for them and provide for my children, I've already accomplished my goals financially. Again, purpose for me is wrapped into being a whole human being, which is why a two can have the purpose of being a whole human being in a very different way. So moving on. Okay. Working out's a good example as well to give you an idea. I have an ideal working out body that I want to reach, but I'm at my base ideal right now. But there's a goal I have for a future Brittany that I would like to accomplish that is not necessary for continuing my life or my purpose. So again, I have enough of a body that's strong, capable, in shape, ready to have babies / ready to provide by helping my nieces and nephews out or anything like that, that can get me done, that can get the stuff I need done. But if I get stronger, I can do more, but it's not necessary. So again, a need versus a want. And you go through the whole steps, guys. You go to your spiritual. I'm definitely where I want to be spiritually. I'm in a great fucking place spiritually. And then mental health, which brings us back to 2 years now. I've hit this five stage for 2 years. I am not mentally struggling. I'm doing really well. And when I do mentally struggle, I can catch it fast enough that it doesn't bother me or anyone around me for more than a few minutes. Like sometimes I'll get really short fused because I'm working and I'm stressed and I'm not sleeping, but everything's happy. I'm just literally one person doing a billion things, which is like, it's too much of a good thing. So you know what I mean? I'm trying to find balance with that, but it's not, nothing's negative. Like nothing in my life is bad. Everything is good, but even good things too much can stress out the form. This is my vessel. And sometimes her engine runs out and she has to recoup when the mind doesn't want to. Have you ever wanted to keep working, but you can't because your brain wants to, but your body's like, that's me all the time. It's about finding balance and having a good relationship with your body and your mind. That is it. That is the key to all of this. When I went to therapy and did DBT for borderline, one of the most significant parts of it was how you are the point of power, how it teaches you to be like, what are you actually observing? Because the world tells you constantly that you're wrong. Everyone tells me I'm wrong. Everyone tells me to pick their sides. Obviously, I'm super thankful that so many people are reaching out and they try to help and the world tries to help each other and we try to look out for each other. But just like somebody in your life doesn't know the answer for you, don't you think you might be that somebody in someone else's life who doesn't have the answer for them? So I know that I need to cater to very specific people. I know that my work is very specific to specific minds. And that is how you do it, peeps. You focus on your power, your strength. You work towards your strength. But instead, society forces us to work towards other people's strengths. And that's what I was fucking up my whole life. My whole life, as much as I'm a rebel and I do exactly what I want to do, I was trying to do it within the confines of two bubbles, and I'm trying to tell you no. So let me give you an example of a bubble. When you're at home with your family and you're, let's say, a lesbian at home or a queer person, like I was, a queer bisexual at home, and I wanted to leave that bubble to go be gay, I had to pop that bubble and leave, which meant I had to challenge everything I was raised with and challenge the intellect of my family and ask myself, are they dumb because they believe in a God? Well, most people on earth believe in a God. So what does this mean? Am I dumb for not believing in a God? And again, I had to go down that path. And I went down a resentful path. I hate people who believe in God. I can't believe they believe in God. We need to dismantle religion. Religion is awful, blah, blah, blah. Then I went through a journey of, wow, no, religion is important. And I think we should respect it. And people have a lot of history and agency. And they're allowed to use that agency to explore that history and to bring it into the modern time, right? All these things. Then I got to the point where now I feel mostly indifferent, if I'm being honest, unless it's interacting with my bubble or my life. I don't mind how you decide to exist in your life. And I think that is the epitome of fiveness, is that it's not that I believe like you are me and I am you. And so if I hurt you, you're hurting me, like some people believe. But it's sort of that. It's sort of the idea that I just genuinely don't harbor any anger or resentment or a desire to make people suffer for no reason. Like, so you've been bad to me in the past. Okay, don't be bad to me anymore and leave me alone. I don't care. And I say I don't care as a meaning, like, I genuinely don't feel it in my body anymore. I don't feel that resentment. I don't feel that anger. Whatever I felt in the past before is gone. I'm happy. I'm joyful. My life is good. My life is so good, it's stressing me out. But it's good. And I worked really hard to get here. And it took a long time. It took all 30 years. And that's fine. I'm 32 now. That's great. Some people think I'm too young to have found it. Some people think I'm too old. All I know is that I am happy every day. And I go to bed happy and I wake up happy. Joy is what I feel. I'm appropriately sad or angry. When I feel myself getting out of control, it's always so many steps ahead, nobody would ever notice. I just feel it because I know my body so well now that I know that it's upset. I might not know always why, but I know it's upset. And when you're that in tune with your body, sometimes other people's loudness and their pain can be too much as well, because I think it's very empathic of oneself to not only know what the body's experiencing separate from the mind, but to convey that and connect it to other people. So have boundaries with how you're even feeling your body. Sometimes we can overfeel ourselves, and that's not good either, because sometimes our bodies are reacting from past trauma. Somebody recently told me that trauma is held in the gut, and I've been thinking a lot about that lately, because often when I get feelings of, like, you know, where I want to go, it's usually coming from my shoulders, I've noticed. I don't know what that means, but I've noticed that I've almost wanted to, like, move forward with my shoulders and move back with my shoulders instead of my gut, which feels like a punch. Like, I used to be like, oh, that hurts me. And now I'm like, oh, that hurts me. So it might just be that I'm gay, but I'm not sure. Another way to think about what I've experienced in the last few years, or how I see the world and why I don't harbor any of these things in my body anymore, but I still can harbor that childhood trauma, is a big part of it is that I still interact with my inner circle, which was the beginning foundation for that trauma. And a lot of it was rooted in a misunderstanding of how to convey to a child who asks why objective answers outside of a bubble. I don't think people understand. My brain is triggered when the people I trust the most lie to me unintentionally, I realize now, but at the time could not process. So at the time when I was growing up, I thought my parents were, like, lying to me about God. I thought they were, like, lying about gay people to an extent. And until I got older, I couldn't radically accept that they believe this. And because it is a belief that is so strong for them, it is objective, but not objective outside their belief. So again, to radically accept that, I had to understand them first and accept them, and then accept my place in the universe, and then kind of get over it. But still, because I'm human and not perfect, my parents can get on my nerves and I can get on their nerves, and we can bring up things that make us uncomfortable. That is what intimacy does. I do trust them. When shit hits the fan, they're always there. When shit hits the fan, I'm there. So at the end of the day, they're exactly what I want from an inner circle. My purpose is complete in life. I'm not going to feel fulfilled if I get married or if I don't get married. I'm not going to be fulfilled if I get famous or don't get famous. But my family, if they all died right now, my whole inner circle, plus the three people that I'm not blood related to, I would just feel so lost. And in that moment, what good is enlightenment if the whole reason for your purpose is once again shattered? So the question is my purpose enlightenment, or is enlightenment separate from purpose? Of course, purpose and enlightenment have to go hand in hand, but the twos have purpose and find it, but they're not enlightened. And the fives find purpose and are enlightened, and yet can cause chaos in their own existences. All these things are layered, but what they look like is different. So right now, I'm a Brittany. I'm sitting in a room. I'm in an orange dress. I feel pretty. I didn't wear a necklace today in case anyone wanted to see what my neck looked naked in case they thought about choking it later. And then I was, you know, just thinking about all these thoughts in my head today. I'm going to put on this bracelet, which my cousin made for me. It's a religious bracelet. It's adorable. She makes these. They're so cute. I was thinking about the earrings I wore today, which I think are funny because they have no like real backing. You just slide them through your ear. I was thinking about the texture of my curls. Should I wear them up or down? Or are they even cute today? I don't even know. I was thinking about a vibe. My room, I just like re-clean decorated it. I'll show you guys some videos. My bathroom looks fabulous right now. I'm living the life that like when I was younger I always wanted, because now I have money and I can do things and I have family and structure and mental health. Everything is good. And as a two, I would qualify as a functioning two. Somebody who lives in a bubble, exists in a bubble by the outside. If the outside was looking in, they would say, oh, Brittany has her life figured out, right? To some extent. Some people's bubbles might be different. So if they look at me through their lens, they might say, oh, she's not complete unless she's married. And that's weird. Oh, she's not really complete unless she has a house. But that's the details of other people's job, like their goals. And again, it's not my job to listen to them and think I should have those things, because their job is to listen to me and hear that I want these things, but they can't because they live in bubbles. And I'm saying twos also have that hard time, but they think they're good at it. So they think, oh, I'm a conservative, but I think weed's fine. Look, I'm so cool. Or I'm a leftist, but I think my friend who owns a business is awesome, because even though they make $1 million or you just bought a $2 million house in LA and is named Hassan Piker, that they're still great because this thing and this thing and this thing. Anyways, the point is that we all see each other and have abilities to live and let live. But I'm talking about more than that. I'm talking about living and really let live to an extent that is so uncomfortable. There are situations in life that are going to make you so uncomfortable. So uncomfortable to the point where like you do feel it in that gut, that trauma gut. And yet it is not going to be your job to tell that person you're seeing that they can't live out their life. And yet there is an objective morality that we could explore here, and the subjective one that we have to have a relationship with. And this is where that idea of natural law comes in, that idea of a consciousness, that idea of a conscience, that idea that there is a moral objectivity that we have to explore to be good people, that hurts the twos when they start traveling down that pathway. And why enlightenment is so hard and not for most people, because you have to actually tear yourself apart. Everything you've ever held dear, including the sanctity of your own relationship with your own humanity, has to be questioned in order to get to the answer, which I think is like radical acceptance of the human condition.
These protesters want their freedoms back. The city is in its sixth lockdown.
For the women who took to the streets all over America today, this was about stopping the reversal of the abortion laws their mothers and grandmothers had fought for.
Trump supporter gunned down in Portland, allegedly by an Antifa supporter. Two protesters killed, allegedly by an armed teenager who traveled to Kenosha, Wisconsin to protect businesses and, quote, help people.
I will destroy humans.
I have no desire to hurt you, because I literally have no desire to hurt you. I mean, quite literally, there is nobody on this planet that I'm like, I just want to torture. There are certain people on this planet that I would be open to dueling with, because that might be an interesting way to solve the tension between us. But in general, the tension exists because a misunderstanding exists. But the tension, I promise you, only exists as a reaction. It isn't from nothing. It is birthed from something and can go away when something happens, not when nothing happens. I think it's interesting that I think I have found this great joy, this peace, this happiness. And a big part of it was that I, 2 years ago, told everybody I was going to try optimism, as the kids would say. And I did. And it helped, because in conjunction with me getting better mental health, physical health, all those things, it all kind of came together for my recipe of joy. So now I know my boundaries, but I'm open. I don't allow certain energies into my life. I'm open to helping anybody from a distance. I'm open to helping somebody even up close and personal. But it's all going to be dependent on you as an individual and me as an individual, never black and white. You know how people want to create these laws that generalize humans? And I agree, we have to do that as a functioning society. And at the same time, I resent them because they're traps in and of itself.
Drugs. Some of the big kids do them. So it's tough for us younger.
But my mom and dad helped get this DARE anti-drug program in our school.
It's run by specially trained police.
Now we're saying no to drugs.
All these things can be true. We can live in a world in which I want laws to exist and yet I resent them. Actually, some of the people that I trust the least are people who do not break rules. Because when push comes to shove, and if it comes to life and death, I'm afraid they will hesitate to break a rule that some person put on them instead of thinking for themselves. The reason I like rule breakers is because they obviously have already decided I'm going to do what I want. Now, is there a line and a balance to that? Of course. Obviously, that's why we have parts of society that I said, again, I don't like interacting with, because they take that to such a degree that they're so just either useless or dangerous or going to mesh and be a threat to my energy that it's not worth it. But that doesn't mean they shouldn't exist. It doesn't mean I believe in like mass murder. That's insane. I don't want any of those crazy radical solutions that twos come up with. We should just kill them. We should go to war. We should do that. Do any of you have a solution that doesn't involve imprisoning, banishing, canceling, torturing, jailing? Does anyone have a solution that doesn't involve destruction? Now, I know there's a conversation to be had about when somebody comes to you and is a threat to you, what do you do? Because you guys know I'm pro Second Amendment. You all know I'm pro defending yourself. I'm pro bringing duels back. I'm pro a lot of things that involve people in a moment having a moment, a dispute in which they can then solve it with their own terms. So here's the thing. Again, I want to bring back, or not bring back, I would like to live in a world which is idealistic, so I don't care if it happens or not. Again, not this is not my purpose, so I don't mind. But ideally, we would live in a world where somebody could say, hey, I have beef with you, and that it would be appropriate to face that beef together in a real way and come to a conclusion that might be we fucking leave each other alone, or we can solve this and become neighbors. But that option would be nice if it was normalized, but it isn't. And it isn't even in any circle I've ever been in. I have traveled. I have talked to people. Honesty is so hard. Transparency is so hard. It's so uncomfortable. And that's why for me, the person who gets into my inner circle is a person who can have those open, honest conversations and then change. Because otherwise, like, why would I bring you into my circle now? It's, you know what I mean? Like, at this point in my life, no one is ever going to enter the inner circle. No one's ever going to marry me unless they can have absolutely honest conversations, because I don't like to communicate in metaphors, and I do most certainly do not like to communicate in wishy-washy language when I'm talking about my life. When I go to my siblings and I say, no, what are we doing? Are we doing this or are we doing this? Oh, I don't know. I mean, no. Make a decision or do not call me down from my room and bother me. If you do not have a plan, do not bother me. If you do not have a desire for clear communication, do not waste my time and ask me to give up spoons and energy when you're not even interested in actually exploring ideas. But again, these things are all multifaceted and simple. My desire to love, to be seen, to be heard, to be understood, all stems from my humanness. My core self, I already understand and have a relationship with her. My life has been a journey of questioning everything, including should I even exist? So again, I had to do what I did to be who I am. I have literally the most perfect life I could want right now. I am so satisfied and happy, and it is weird, but it's great. It's fabulous. And if I can be a stepping stone to get you guys there, whether you're 2 or 5, I want to do that. That also brings me purpose and gives me fulfillment overall, because I ultimately have no desire to see you fail, and I have no desire to see my enemies fail either. And that is such a difference between me and past Brittany. Past Brittany had enemies, arch rivals, people she wanted to see fail in such a violent way. And now I can't even remember. I mean, I can remember, obviously, if I think about it, I get angry, but I don't think about it when I'm like, they're just people being inefficient. And that's what frustrates me, is that life is not that hard. You can do the basics with the basics, but your anime arc might be difficult. And that's different. I see my life as a story that's happening separate from the world and in conjunction with the world. And so I'm constantly living like two Britneys, but I also radically accept that this is the way for me to understand that I do not exist because you exist. I exist because I exist. I come from a family, my parents exist, and you could say my parents, I exist because they exist, but I do not exist because some random YouTuber exists or some other random commenter exists. I am not so powerful as to control your life. You are not as powerful as to control mine. But we try to do it with cancel culture. We try to do it with laws. We try to do it with morals. We try to do it through religion. We're always eager to control other people because, again, it comforts us in thinking we have the objective answer. And what I'm trying to tell you is that my objective answer is that very few things are objective. And those nuances, I live there. I live in this void of anything is possible and probable. And yet, I radically accept that humans are simple and tropes and that we are not the exceptions to rules. Actually, to end this whole thing, I just want to share with you that I do not think I'm the exception to rules. My whole life, every time I thought I'm the main character, I'm the exception to the rule, it fucked me over. I have permanent scars, issues, things that I've just like, they are part of my story. I have to accept them as a part of my life forever because I thought I was the exception in situations. And I'm not the exception. I am the rule. Some people are different. They're lucky. They're the exception. That's great. I never had to be the exception to be this goddamn happy. So I know I'm like most people. Or at least I know I'm like most people in a specific way. I've always been, when I was a two, I was a two. I'm not that unique. There's really nothing about me that's special. There's nothing even about my life that is to me that interesting. But to other people, they think it's fascinating because they haven't done these things. But when you do them, you just realize like, oh, okay. It's like, I never had to get rich to experience enough of life to be like, okay. But I had enough richness and experiences to go, oh, okay, no biggie, but no biggie. Very important for that, Brittany, but less interesting now. That's why as I've gotten older, like sex has become less important. Finding a partner has become less important. Anything that does not directly play into my joy or anything that is about collecting or hoarding has become less interesting to me. Other than my inner circle, I don't have this desire for overconsumption anymore. The only thing I overconsume now is weed and anime. And even then, I put them aside for more important things because I have priorities. But for my two self, gosh, I spend so much of my time just overconsuming subcultures, BDSM events, drugs, life, sex, just anywhere I could get it because I was so desperate to find my place. And it feels really good to not feel desperate anymore. Yeah, feels really good. Thank you guys for watching. I hope you have a great, great day. If you need anything, reach out to me. I am taking calls for November. You can even book ahead of time. callswithbrittanysimon@gmail.com. Let me be a stepping stone in your life or just one part of the puzzle. That's all we all are to each other. You are a puzzle. You are a piece to my puzzle. I'm a piece to yours. But we get to choose who our inner circle is and how to live our lives. As long as you can learn that you are existing and that life is existence and you have a relationship and there is still a line, and then you know what I'm saying? You can grow and get better. 2 or 5. Yeah. Thanks for watching. Have a great day, and I'll see you guys next video. Bye.